Hi there. Does having the right camera settings make a great photo? No, not really. What does is having a vision for your photography. And in this video, I'm going to break down for you what having a vision means for me. So, of course, if you're new to photography and you don't properly understand your settings, you are going to have to think about them a lot. I get that. But after a while, the settings become second nature. And I think many people never really move on from obsessing about the settings. And I think as photographers, we run the risk of thinking far too much about the technical aspects of photography than we do about the artistic aspects of photography, making a nice picture that people want to look at. I've met many photographers who've got masses and masses of technically perfect photos. But are they photos that draw people in and make people want to look at them for longer? I don't think so. So thinking about the artistic aspect of photography and having a vision for your photos is really important. So today I'm out having a ramble through this wonderful landscape, scouting for things that I might want to photograph later on in the year. And as I've been walking around, I've been thinking a lot about a question that I've been being asked increasingly frequently recently, and that is, what settings do I need to photograph X? So people might want to know what settings to photograph a bird in flight or an insect on a flower. And that's really an impossible question to answer because there are so many different aspects that lead to that decision. You know, I don't know what the light is going to be like at the location that you're at. You may want to make different choices about the photo, and that's only considering if you want to get the correct exposure or the exposure that your camera tells you is correct. You know, you may want to go for a slightly different depth of field and have more in focus, or you might want a shallower depth of field and have more foreground and background blur. And then you've got the considerations that are outside the correct exposure. So you may want to overexpose and go for something that's more high key, or you may want to underexpose and really darken those shadows down, or even go for something that's backlit and silhouetted, and they're not going to come with a correct exposure. So it's impossible to answer those kind of things, but you having an understanding of the type of photo that you want to take will allow you to make the choices that you need to get that photo. So what I've been thinking about instead is, what does make a great photo? And I regularly reflect on my best photos and think about, what is it that I did that made that photo good? And I think it comes down to three things: observation, pre-visualisation, and inspiration. And so I'm going to talk about those now with three examples. So for the first point, observation, I want to show you this example from my waders video. So you can see behind me here the massive mud flats, and there were pools and channels of water as the sea receded. I found a small pool amongst some mounds of mud that had a really nice balance. The lower and upper parts were approximately parallel, and the left and right mounds have some balance and some symmetry in their shapes. I realised it would make a nice picture, and I was actually hoping for a slightly larger bird to come along, something like a curlew, and fly over that pool so that I could capture the bird in flight and get its reflection as it flew across the water. But I was over the moon when this little group of plover landed. So this shot wasn't about the settings. Any aperture would be fine as long as the birds were in focus. Any shutter speed would be fine as long as it was sufficient to freeze the action as the plover landed. And the ISO is irrelevant as you apply noise reduction. So what made this shot wasn't the settings. It was my observation of the landscape and finding a small portion of it that had some nice balance. And this photo is one that regularly gets lots of recognition from the people who view it, above and beyond some of my other wader photos. Being the photographer who took this photo, I can explain my vision to you. And as fellow photographers, you can look at this photo, analyse it, discuss it, and understand why it makes a nice photo. But to a non-photographer, they may look at it and just have an inherent feeling that it's nice because they don't share the same language that you and I do about visual art. They can't express why it's nice, they just feel that it is. And that's where the magic of photography comes in. So next, let's talk about pre-visualisation. And I want to show you this example of a green woodpecker. And of my green woodpecker photos, this is the one that generally gets the best reaction. So prior to taking this photograph, I'd been at this location a number of times and I'd got some really nice close-up photos of the green woodpecker. But I wanted to get something that showed the bird slightly more in its environment. And I spotted at the far end of the field where I'd been photographing, there were these silver birch trees with the leaves turning a nice orange colour. And I realised that if I just blurred them out enough, they would make a really nice backdrop and just give a hint at the environment that that bird was in. And I changed the orientation to portrait. And so the bird is a lot smaller in the frame than it is in the other three examples that I'm going to show you. So in this one here, we can see that there's beautiful golden light from the morning sun. And that really makes this photo. Here's another one. This one is possibly my personal favourite. And on this green woodpecker, you can see that its feathers are all ruffled. There's lots of nice contrast in the picture. And I just love the overall feel of this one. And the third example is all about the bird's pose. It's got that dramatic look that we sometimes see with green woodpecker. And that's what's attractive about this very simple shot. So let's compare them side by side with the one that gets a more positive reaction than the others. So in the shot with the trees in the background, the light is very flat. It's certainly not what would be regarded as nice light in the same way it is with this golden hour shot. The bird doesn't have the same interest in its plumage with the feathers blowing up in the breeze. And it's certainly a very standard pose compared to this dramatic one. But regardless of that, the photo with the trees draws more attention. And the important thing about this photo was that I'd pre-visualised it. So I'd got myself into a position and waited for the bird to turn up so that I could get exactly the kind of photo that I wanted to take. Now, doing something like this can be really difficult if you tend to shoot opportunistically, i.e. you just walk around and photograph whatever you see. You might by chance get a really nice photo, absolutely. But if you go back and photograph the same subject again and again, you'll start to learn about the subject and its habits and the environment that it's in. And you can start to make choices that enable you to get much nicer pictures than you tend to get opportunistically. So now let's talk about inspiration. And for this, I want to show you a photograph from my rabbits video. Now in that video, I took lots and lots of backlit photos that were silhouetted in the golden hour sunlight. And this particular one is one that often gets a lot of attention when I show people my rabbit photos. It's a really calming, peaceful photo of the rabbit sat there with some solitude in a field, just enjoying that morning sunlight. And in that video, I explained at length, probably a little too long to be fair, how I'd done my thinking to arrive at the type of photo that I wanted to take. So I'd done my research, found out where the rabbits were, and I'd looked at what the lighting conditions were going to be like the next day when I was going to do the photos. And so I made some choices about the types of photos that I wanted to take. And I explained all of that thinking in the video. But prior to making that video, I had been consuming quite a bit of portraiture. And I'd been watching some videos where there was a photographer taking photos of models that had got rim lighting. So you could just see the outline of their hair just glowing with some beautiful rim lights. And I wanted to achieve the same kind of effect. And if we look here at the rabbit, you can see that its fur is just lit up around the periphery. But let me tell you, this isn't a technically perfect picture. If you look at where the whiskers meet the face, you'll see that some of them are blown out. But regardless of this, people still like the photo. And that's because of the effect that it creates. And the reason that I created this effect was through getting some inspiration from another genre. So I would recommend that you go out there and consume all types of photography and you'll get some inspiration. So whether it's portraiture, fashion, wedding photography, food photography, there are some really interesting things out there. And particularly with food photography, there's a great overlap with macro because many of the techniques that food photographers take, which is also, let's face it, close-up photography similar to macro, many of those techniques are very similar to what you would use in macro. And you might find that through looking at another form of photography that you get some inspiration for a compositional device that someone uses that maybe we don't typically use in woodland or landscape photography. And you may look at some portraiture and enjoy something about the colour palette of a picture and want to get a similar colour palette, but maybe with a wildlife subject in it. So go out there and consume all different types of photography and draw inspiration from outside of nature. And you can look at books, magazines, websites, blogs, videos, all sorts of things in order to consume that photography. So stop obsessing about settings and go out there and get yourself a vision for the type of photos that you want to take. Go and consume lots of different types of photography. But if you're looking for more inspiration in the meantime, why not check out this video? Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.